hate theater.
Well, it's so disappointing, isn't it?
You know what I do when I'm sitting in a darkened theater waiting for the show to begin? I pray. Oh, dear God, please let it be a good show. And let it be short, oh Lord in heaven, please. 2 hours is fine, 3 hours is too much. Keep the actors out of the audience, God. I didn't pay good money to have the fourth wall come crashing down around my ears. I just want a story and a few good songs that will take me away. I just want to be entertained. I mean, isn't that the point? Amen. You know, there used to be a time when people sat in darkened theaters and thought to themselves, what have George and Ira Gershwin got for us tonight? Or can Cole Porter pull it off again? Now it's, please, Elton John, must we continue this charade? It used to be, sitting there in the dark, you knew that when the show began, you would be taken to another world. A world full of color and music and glamour. And you thought to yourself, my God, when are they going to bring up the lights? Oh, how things have changed. Hello. How are we today? I'm feeling a little blue myself, you know, a little anxious for no particular reason. A little sad that I should feel anxious at this age. You know, a little self-conscious anxiety brought upon by a non-specific sadness. A state I call blue. Anyway, whenever I'm feeling this way, blue, I like to listen to my music. So, I was going through my records this morning and yes, records. And I was about to put on the soundtrack recording of Meredith Wilson's The Music Man. I had a craving for the young Ronnie Howard. But then I thought to myself, no. No, let's have a treat. Let's dive into the decadent world of the 1920s, when the champagne flowed and the caviar chilled, and all the world was a party. For the wealthy, anyways. So, I dug about, and what did I find? But one of my favorite shows, Gabe Lindstein's The Drowsy Chaperone. Remember? Music by Julie Gable, lyrics by Sidney Stein. It's a two-record set, remastered from the original recording made in 1928. It has the full cast, including Beatrice Stockwell as the chaperone. Oh! Isn't she elegant? And this is a full 15 years before she became Dame Beatrice Stockwell. Can you believe it? Here, let me read to you what it says on the back. It says, mix-ups, mayhem, and a gay wedding. Of course, the phrase gay wedding has a different meaning now, but back when it just meant fun. And, well, that's just what this show is. Fun. So, would you indulge me? Would you let me play my record for you?
Sure.
Yeah. Oh, I was hoping you'd say yes. Oh, I absolutely adore this show so much. Yes, Alec. I love that sound. To me, it's like the sound of a time machine starting up. All right, now. Let's visualize. Imagine, if you will, it's November 1928. You've just arrived at the doors of the Morrison Theater in New York. It's a bit cold outside. Remember when it's been cold November? Not anymore. November's been August now. It's global warming. Well, dude, anyway, it's a bit cold outside. And a heavy gray sheet is falling from the sky. You don't care, because you're here to see a Broadway show. Thank you. overtures. Overtures are out of style now. I miss them. To me, it's like the show's way of welcoming you in. Hello. Welcome. The meal begins shortly, but in the meantime, would you like an appetizer? That's what an overture is, a musical appetizer. A poo-poo platter of tunes, if you will. Something new. Sounds like a dance tune, kind of rollicking. Maybe involving pirates. But don't worry, there are no pirates. Ebenezer-eyed groom, a heady producer, jovial gangster posing as pastry chefs, a flaky Corrine, a lad of the folio, and an aviatrix. Oh, and of course, my favorite character of all, the drowsy chaperone. What more do you need for an evening's entertainment? And we will dig along. I don't even know what that means. All right, I'll lead you through this record as best as I can. But don't worry, it won't be hard to follow. So, we begin with a welcome from the love-struck groom. Oh.
Well, I just wanted to thank you all for coming. I tell you, I must be some lucky fellow. Why, who would have thought that I, Robert Martin, would be marrying a glamorous showgirl? And that glamorous showgirl would be willing to give up a successful career for me, Robert Martin. Now, if it weren't for prohibition, I'd say, let's raise a glass.
Here!
Miss Janet Vandegraaff, the most beautiful girl in the world.
Oh. Absolutely not!
What?
Excuse me?
Come here. The groom mustn't see his bride on his wedding day. It's bad luck.
George.
I hope you heard that, because that's the plot. Basically. Hang on to the ride.
All right. Breakfast will be served in the Arabian room.
Oh, my.
I say, isn't it a little early in the day to be drinking?
I don't understand the question.
Look! You keep Janet away from Robert, you understand? You're the chaperone. That's your only job.
Aye, aye, mon capitaine.
Oh, Robert, who's my little monkey?
I am. I'm your little monkey.
Go!
So the bride and groom are whisked away, and we turn our attention to the B-plot, which involves the producer.
Mr. Phelpsick?
Getting married and leaving show business?
Mr. Phelpsick?
Doesn't she know I got obligations?
Mr. Phelpsick! I could be your leading lady. You said it yourself. I'm useless in the chorus.
Kitty, for the last time, you ain't got what it takes.
But I've been taking lessons, singing, acting, ballet.
Ballet?
Yeah, and I'm pretty good too. Last week I auditioned for Swanee Lake.
A little annotation. Kitty and Felsig were a couple in real life. Jack and Sadie Adler. Now, this is a familiar comic construct. A stupid woman and a long-suffering companion. Well, she appears stupid, but she does something very clever in the end that makes everyone wonder whether it was all just an act. The irony here is that, Sadie actually was quite stupid. Jack had to explain all the jokes to her, apparently. But still, she had a wonderful career on the stage. At that time, the theater was the only place where the stupid people could earn a decent living. This is before television, of course.
Kitty, I don't have time for this!
Oh.
I put you before, Mr. Fountain!
Not now.
Perhaps a nice profiterole!
Boys, I'm not hungry.
Oh, then perhaps we could give you something else to chew on!
Yeah, something that I vote!
What?
Your confusion is to be expected. Although we stand here before you in the guise of innocent pastry chefs, we are also...
And primarily...
Employees of a certain individual.
A certain individual?
A certain individual.
Who happens to be the largest single investor in Felsig's faults. He has sent us here...
As pastry chefs.
To express his concern about Miss Vandegraaff's impending nuptials.
Specifically...
That if she gets married and leaves the show, then there ain't no show!
Say! Don't I know you? No! You don't! Have you spent any time in Toledo?
Have you ever spent any time in a coma?
No, but I got a cousin who lives in Seattle.
Kitty, boys, you tell your boss that this wedding is never going to happen. You have my word.
Oh, well, take your word on record.
But to go back on that word would be a recipe for disaster. Huh. Now, we hope we've made ourselves perfectly clear.
One can only hope.
You've just gotta be kidding me.
That's right, relax.
Don't part with me!
All right, you can drop the pastry chef routine.
Alas, we ganache.
We're on the lamb.
Lamb's an entree, a macaroon.
The gangsters were played by interchangeable vaudeville duo the Tall Twins, John and Patricia Tall. They were born Abraham Mandela Moss Laskowitz, but were renamed Ellis Island by a sarcastic immigration official. They were typical of the early Broadway gangster, full of wordplay and stylized movement. Not very intimidating. Unless you find dancers intimidating. Which I do. But for reasons that would not be appropriate to the situation.
Now, we'll leave the matter in your hands, Mr. Felzig. In the meantime, feel free to browse the dessert carousel.
Try the Toledo surprise.
It's to die for.
Holy heck, Mr. Felzig! They're gangsters!
Very perceptive! Now go powder your face!
Okay!
I've got to stop this wedding, but how? Oh, Lord in heaven! How?
I always thought that moment was a little bit overplayed. So, with the story well on its way, let's go to the groom's room.
Hey there, handsome. Show me those pearly whites.
The groom was played by the dashing Percy Hyman. He started out his career as the Albright toothpaste man. Fabulous smile adorned every tube. Albright was hugely popular in the early 20s because it, well, it contained cocaine. It's true. If you look at the label, it's the fifth ingredient down, right after sugar. Still, it wasn't long before he became a huge matinee idol.
Now, don't you worry. It's perfectly normal for a groom to be nervous on his wedding day. It is? Of course.
I love Percy Hyman. Some people say he was a bad actor. But to those people, I say shut up.
Hey there, Mr. Mirrorman. Satan and Duck Awaken. Trembling like them fraidy cats do. Something make me bothering you. Cold feet, cold feet. Brother, you've got cold feet. You can make them cold feet hot with a little rhythm. Young feet, old feet. Can't be uncontrolled feet. Rhythm make them cold feet trot down the aisle. Frosty arches, they can learn to swing. Icy toes can jive. Ha! Wedding marches, laid in ragtime swing. Make frigid souls come alive and take that dive. Ha! Gold feet, schmold feet. Turn them into bold feet. Rhythm make them cold feet.
Hot.
Oh, you don't say.
Oh, really? No, I have an idea.
How about you slime back into your dirty butthole, you unholy backstabbing worm? No. Oh. Now I have to find another minister.
George.
Oh. What are you up to?
I'm singing a song an old street bum taught me. A Dixie remedy for wedding day jitters.
Ha! You think you've got jitters? You got the easy part. All you gotta do is kiss the bride. I still gotta get rice, ears, and a minister. I have the weight of the wedding on my shoulders.
George, it sounds like you've got cold feet.
What do I got?
Cold feet.
What do I want?
Bold feet.
What do I do? Scold feet?
No! You like the cold feet? Ha! Ha! Yeah.
Alright.
Ha! Nice and smooth, George.
Yeah.
Wonderful performer. I like to think of him panting and sweating after a long dance routine. He's still alive, you know. I saw him on the television recently celebrating his 100th birthday. To say that the passing years had taken their toll on him would be a grotesque understatement. They wheeled him out, and he had that wide-eyed expression of pained confusion that God reserves for the very, very old on their birthdays. You know, the one that says, who are you? Who am I? And why is that cake on fire? You know what I'm talking about? Anyways.
All right. That's enough of that. Dancing around like a fool.
I'm sorry, George. I'm just trying to calm my nerves. It is my wedding day, after all.
Well, you could have snapped an ankle. Dancing is way too dangerous.
George.
Why don't you go for a skate instead? That's what I do when I want to blow off some steam. Here.
George, what would I do without you?
Perfect. Oh, no! You can't go looking like that, my friend.
What?
You might see Janet.
Oh, no. What think, George.
Yeah, I got it. Here, put on this blindfold.
Perfect.
All right.
Nice and tight. Make sure it's tight.
We go.
George, you think of everything.
I'm just looking out for you, my friend. Go, and no more dancing. Wedding bells will ring. Wedding bells will chime. Wedding bells will celebrate.
Just ignore it. Does this occasionally. It rings. It'll stop soon. Just ignore it. What do you want from me, your cousin phone?
Hello. You have reached my answering machine. Leave a short message after the tone, and I'll call you back at my convenience. And I'm most likely in, so do not take this as an opportunity to burgle.
That's it. Moment's ruined. Thank you. Thank you, life. It's like a cell phone going off in a theater. God, I hate that. Hello, how are you doing today?
Oh, I'm doing pretty good. How about you?
Well, I'm at the theater right now, ruining the moment. How about you?
Well, I couldn't get out of that, so I thought I'd ruin the moment by proxy.
Sorry. Let's just shake it off. Let's return our minds back to 1928. They didn't have cell phones back in 1928, although I'm sure they had something for the ruining of moments. Bugles or something. And we find the bride, the glamorous Janet Vandergraaff, entertaining questions from reporters as she lounges by the pool.
music in the Ile de France. He amused me with stories of his father's oil interests. We spooned briefly. Then he proposed.
So you won't be returning to the stage?
Ever? I shan't.
You shan't?
I shan't.
What?
Of course. One more question. Yes.
Why in the world would anyone put olives in a Gibson?
I got a question. How can you give up the footlights when you know very well you got grease paint in your veins?
Oh, Victor.
Oh, Janet, please. I am begging you. Dump the mug and stay with the Follies. I'll do anything. I'll... Oh, fine. I'll put your name above mine on the marquee.
Oh, Victor, if you think this is about vanity, you couldn't be more wrong. I don't want to show off no more. I don't want to sing tunes no more. I don't want to ride moons no more. I don't want to show up. I don't want to wear this no more. I play the saucy Swiss this no more. Below my signature no more. I don't want to show up.
Janet, please.
Don't try to control me. Made up my mind, and that's it. I quit. I'm leaving it all behind. I don't wanna be cute no more. Make the gentleman hoot no more.
Hey,
I don't wanna wear roots no more. I don't wanna show off.
She won't show off no more.
That's it.
Hey,
Danzig, it is painfully obvious that Miss Van de Graaff has no desire to continue a life on stage.
Can't you see? It's killing us all.
Oh!
Don't worry, boys. This isn't over yet.
Yeah, I'm surprised she didn't do an encore.
Roberts is the bride. She was the oops girl, remember? Shirley, you remember the oops girl, don't you? Don't you people read? She was billed as the girl whose sexual energy was so great, it would cause men around her to have accidents. Spill their drinks, drive their cars into trees, and she would go, oops! Well, I'm not really doing it justice, but people ate it up. She made a whole series of films. Oops. Oops, girl. Oops, girl, come home. And oops, girl at sea. Which won an Oscar for special effects.
Okay. Begin groveling didn't work. On to plan B. And for that, I'm going to need an accomplice. Someone gullible. With loose morals. I'm going to need what do you call them? A European!
La 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 la!
In walks Aldolfo, self-proclaimed ladies' man. Aldolfo is played by former silent film star and world-class alcoholic Roman Bartelli. He was the one who later drank himself to death in his chateau in Nice, remember? It was 5 days before they found the body. By that time, it had been partially consumed by his poodles. Well, it was only partially consumed.
Excuse me, I don't believe we've met.
Ah, I am Aldolfo.
You are Aldolfo?
Yes, I am Aldolfo.
Not the Aldolfo.
Yes, I am Aldolfo.
Funny, you don't look like a scoundrel.
Yes, I am a... Wait, what?
Right now, I just overheard the groom saying that Aldolfo is a scoundrel.
Oh.
I just heard him say that.
Aldolfo is a scoundrel.
Those very words.
Aldolfo, a scoundrel.
It's like I'm hearing it again.
Well, this is outrageous. Well, he's saying this to people, to beautiful ladies with chichis for making love? Well, I must.
You must take matters into your own hands.
Yes. I must take this groom into my hands and kill him.
Yes. No. Don't kill him. Just hurt him enough so that he can't get married.
Show me to this groom.
What? What?
What kind of man is groom? Is he a big man?
Well, he's...
Is he a burly man?
Well, he's big on the outside of it.
No. Aldolfo does not fight big men. Small, pale, wheezy little dwarf people that Aldolfo can punt. Very far away, but no big men.
So, you're a lover, not a fighter.
See, Aldolfo is a lover of beautiful ladies. Some say that I am the king of romance.
Well, you know what they say. The best way to get back at a man is through his...
Door?
No, get back at a man. Through his...
Window!
No, revenge! Back at a man! Through his...
Through his... There is no other way. I'm not Santa Claus coming down chimney.
Through his woman! Yes, Aldolfo, you must seduce his bride.
His woman!
His bride.
Oh. Aldolfo will make love to bride. That will show people that Aldolfo is not scoundrel. Show me to this bride. What?
What?
What kind of woman is bride? Is she a big woman?
No.
Is she a burly woman?
No. She's the cat's pajamas.
Pajamas.
She's a looker. She's an attractive lady.
Show me to this cat in pajamas. Adolfo will make her purr.
Stop it.
Like a cat in pajamas. Purr. No.
Roman Bartelli chewing the scenery. You certainly couldn't get away with a performance like that nowadays, could you? Oh no. Mature contemporary audiences are too sophisticated to enjoy broad racial stereotypes like that on the stage. So we've banished them to Disney. Let the children sort it out.
Provide the liquor for the party! But remember, underling, we have to be discreet.
Yes, madam.
It is prohibition after all.
Oh, I'm aware of that, madam.
We'll have to use code words! Oh. For instance, if someone asks for a glass of ice water, it means they want a glass of vodka! Have you got that?
Yes, madam.
Are you sure? Maybe you should write it down.
Oh, I understand, madam. A glass of ice water is a glass of vodka.
Oh, what's a glass of ice water?
Vodka.
Oh, ice water?
Vodka.
Oh, ice vodka. Oh. Well, you see, that's settled then. One less thing to do. Have a glass of ice water. I found our meeting with the pastry chefs rather trying, and I would certainly enjoy a refreshing glass of ice water.
Your glass of ice water, madam.
No! That was pure vodka, you poo!
I hate this scene.
Now I do need a glass of ice water.
Oh. A glass of ice water?
Yes, ice water. Are you going deaf?
Would that I were.
You could say where this is going, can't you? It's really just a series of spit takes.
Your glass of ice water, madam.
No! That was pure vodka, you pooped!
Oh. You know, in some ways, the Drowsy Chaperone was quite progressive.
Your glass of ice water, madam.
Oh, that was your vodka, you fool!
Yes, some elements were quite progressive. Others were stale in 1928. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna skip ahead.
Get some lime juice, madam.
Lime juice? For heaven's sakes, why?
I'm going to wring out my eyebrows and make myself a gimlet.
Underling! Underling! Oh.
Now, you're probably asking yourself, what was that routine doing in the show? Well, it's really very simple. There's a song coming up, and they needed some time backstage to allow for the set change. It's mechanics.
Oh, in a few hours, I'm going to be Miss Robert Martin. Oh, my head is spinning.
Yes, life is a mad whirlwind.
Now, this is a really interesting scene. This is the only time in the show when Jane Roberts and Beatrice Stockwell are alone together on stage. Now, Jane Roberts was an emerging star, but Beatrice Stockwell was already well established and a force to contend with.
I'm just so full of apprehension, but I suppose that's normal considering the circumstances. Have you ever been married, Chaperone?
No, I drink for pleasure, not out of necessity.
We're out of ice water, Mrs. Tartedale.
Your glass of ice water, madam. I'm afraid we're fresh out of olives.
Have you ever been married, underling?
Oh, heavens, no. If I'm going to serve a woman, I prefer to be paid for my efforts.
Oh, you too. I know it seems crazy to give up a successful career to marry a man I hardly know, but somehow, for some reason, when I look into his eyes, his big, funky eyes, oh, gee, I get all woozy, and that's love, isn't it?
Not necessarily. The wooziness could be caused by any number of things, I mean. Woozy right now, I'm certainly not in love.
Now, Beatrice Stockwell was famous for her rousing anthems. She had detained and inspired the troops in every major world conflict up to and including the Falklands War. Although by that time, she was in her late 80s and her anthems didn't so much rouse as stupefy. But still, she demanded that a rousing anthem be included in every show she ever did, even if it wasn't entirely appropriate. But still, you couldn't just say no to her. That is star power.
Really, you're not being the least bit helpful. Couldn't you just allay my fears with a few choice words of inspiration?
Inspiration? Really, my dear, that's not my forte.
Yes, but if you...
As you stumble along a life's funny journey, as you stumble along into the blue, we look here and we look there, seeking answers anywhere, never sure of where to turn or what to do. Still we bumble our way through life's crazy labyrinth, barely knowing left from right, nor right from wrong.
Thank you.
basically, she sings a arousing anthem about alcoholism. That's what I love about her. She just does her own thing regardless of the needs and concerns of others. My mother was like that.
That was quite inspiring, Chaperone, but I'm still conflicted. I don't know if Robert is the one for me or not.
Oh, my dear, that is something you will have to decide for yourself.
But I just have to know if he loves me.
Why don't you ask him? Yes. Why don't you say, Rata, do you love me?
It's Robert. Oh. And I'm not allowed to see him. In fact, it's your job to keep me away from him.
You're right. And I take the responsibility very seriously. However, I'm just at the moment feeling terribly, terribly drowsy. I'm afraid I'll have to lie you down. Now, whatever you do, don't go wandering through the garden, seeking out your fiancé to ask him the question on which your future happiness depends.
Why, thank you, Chaperone. I just have to know if he loves me. Oh,
such a skinny little fool. Still, I envy her. When will love come crashing through my door?
La 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 la!
Look who it is! It's Adolfo, come to seduce the bride!
I am Adolfo!
When you're listening to this next part, try not to think about the poodles.
I am Adolfo, and you are the bride?
No, I'm not.
What? Well, this is a bridal suite, then! Well, there is no one else here, so you must be the bride.
Interesting argument, but I'm afraid you are a moron.
What?
Me? No bride.
Perhaps I could take a message.
Oh, yes, very good, very good. Dear Miss Van de Graaff Bride, I must make love to you and transport you to that place of ecstasy. The sooner the better. Signed, Adolfo, King of Romance.
Well, you solved my little Ross. You've found me out.
So you are the bride?
Apparently, yes. Oh, take me, Adolfo.
No. Not Adolfes, Adolfo. You must remember my name. You must get it right for when we are making love. And you are screaming. You must say the right name or to spoil everything. How might I make you remember? I'm sure that you have heard the name Adolfo, a ladies' man who wins the claim Adolfo. Well, lovely miss, I am the same Adolfo. I introduce myself, I am Adolfo.
Nice to meet you, shall we?
Not so fast, so just in case you didn't hear Adolfo, I'll try to make it very clear, Adolfo. The lovely ladies always hear Adolfo. I will repeat myself, I am Adolfo.
Understood.
I can sing it high, Adolfo. I can sing it low, Adolfo. I can sing it very fast, Adolfo. I can sing it very slowly. I would do it now, but it would take hours! Now let me see if you can remember my name!
I'll give it a shot!
Now this is the fellow that you see, Adolfo. And how should you refer to me, Adolfo? And who is it? I'll always be Adolfo. Now sing it proudly, you are Adolfo. Now let me spell it out for you. For those of you lovely ladies probably not here the first time, because maybe you are hard of hearing or something. I don't know. It goes.
Fantasy to be swept off her feet by a Latin lover. I mean, a real Latin lover. Not a buffoon. What? That's what musicals are all about, right? Romantic fantasy. Falling in love at the tip of a hat. Spontaneous tangoing. Suddenly finding yourself in an insanely romantic setting.
I'm an accident waiting to happen. Whoa, bum ba dum bum bum ba dum bum. Da 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 dum bum.
Whoa, look out!
Don't worry, madam. I'm getting married today, so I have to wear this blindfold.
Blindfold?
I'm sorry. Who am I speaking with?
Why, it's me. Mimi. Mimi from France.
This scene couldn't be more ridiculous.
So, you're marrying Jeannette Van de Graaff, no?
Oui.
I hear she's very beautiful.
Oui.
And glamorous.
Oui.
Is it true that she has an exceptionally broad range and excels at playing both comedic and dramatic roles?
Say, I'm having trouble placing your accent. What part of France are you from?
The middle part. Where they make the toast. So, you were telling me about your, how do you say it in English? Fiancé?
That's right.
Tell me, when was the moment when you knew she was the one for you?
It's a funny story, actually. We were standing on the Lido deck of the Ile de France.
Yes.
I was amusing her with stories of my father's oil interests.
And then what happened?
And then I looked into her eyes, her big, glamorous eyes, and I felt all, woozy.
And then you fell. And then you fell.
Yes. Whoa. Right on my keister. And I said, well, darling, I guess I don't have my sea legs yet.
But we haven't left the dock.
That's what she said. And that's when I knew it must be love.
And then you said,
and then I said, there was a time I could stop on a dime. Forbearance was one of my talents. But since you've been around, I can't hold my ground. Whoa! I'm consistently losing my balance. I'm an accident waiting to happen. I'm a mishap about to ensue. I'm a toy on a stem, a three-legged chair, a hem that's been caught by a shoe. When my two lovesick arms started flapping, there was nothing my angels could do. I'm an accident waiting to happen, so how be I happen to you? He joined in.
When men say I'm sweet and they fall at my feet, my heart doesn't beat any faster. But when you lose control, it touches my soul. So I'm bracing myself for disaster. You're an accident waiting to happen.
That's right.
I'm the rags in the cellar.
A broken umbrella.
A branch hanging loose from the tree.
I can see myself jumping and clapping. Or a man who lives dangerously.
You're an accident waiting to happen.
So hurry and
and then we kissed.
You're an accident waiting to happen. So hurry and happen to me.
Wait a minute! Oh. You kissed a strange French girl on your wedding day!
Oh no! What have I done? Wait! Wait! Oh.
Well, it seems the blindfold and the fake French accent have led to a terrible misunderstanding. Will it all work out in the end? Of course it will. It's not real. It's a musical. Everything always works out in musicals. In the real world, nothing ever works out, and the old people that burst in the song are the hopelessly deranged.
Mr. Felsig!
Where is that philandering foreigner?
Mr. Felsig!
How long can it take to seduce one bride?
Mr. Felsig, you don't need Janet no more!
Kitty, not now!
I've been working on a mind reading act! Presenting Kitty, the incomprehensible! Now think of something.
Oh, I'm thinking of something, all right!
Wait! I'm getting it. Milk, a loaf of rye bread, and don't forget to shave your legs! Huh?
You're reading your own mind, you idiot!
Oh. No wonder it was so easy!
Mr. Felsig!
It seems that the wedding is proceeding according to schedule.
Now it's time you received your just desserts. What do you say, partner? Should we whip up something special for Mr. Felsig?
Yeah, how about a Toledo surprise?
Ah, an inspired choice.
A Toledo surprise? I never heard of that one before.
No, you haven't. Those people that have heard of it are generally never heard from again.
We'll share the recipe with you.
First you chop the nuts.
Then you pound the dough.
Then you bake it up nice and slow.
And then you got the Toledo. Toledo surprise!
Could you run that by me again?
It's a very simple recipe, Mr. Felsig.
First you chop the nuts.
Then you pound the dough.
Then you make it up nice and slow.
And then you got the Toledo.
Toledo surprise. Say, why don't we give him a little taste?
All right.
Hold it. What style? What grace? What rhythm? Open up your fists. Now shake them. Now, give me that recipe one more time. Da-da-da-da-da-da!
Chop the nuts, pound the dough, bake it up nice and slow. Then you got a Toledo, Toledo surprise.
Now sell it!
Hit the peat, peel the skin, mash it up, throw it in. That's a tasty Toledo, Toledo surprise.
You're cooking.
You beat it up, then you sweet it up. Splendido!
Oh, Toledo surprise!
Your boys are natural!
Honest.
Keep it up, I'll go work on the contract!
Hey.
5, 6, 7, 8!
It's fantastic! What's going on here?
Kitty, I'm developing a new act!
Toledo surprise!
You mean you're putting gangsters in the show, you won't put me in it? They're not even in the union!
You got it all wrong! The new act! It's for you, Kitty, and these boys are your backup dancers!
Backup dancers? Holy cats! What that hot Toledo does to my libido! Good? Yes, Toledo! Shivery yum yum! Surprise! Squeeze the cream, grease the pan, lick the spoon, flip the flan.
Wedding is off!
What?
Oh, no, Flas made love to the bride!
Wow.
Ooh.
Ew.
That is not the bride, you idiot. That is a chaperone.
What?
The wedding is off.
Wait, the wedding is off.
What?
Robert kissed the French girl. Her name is Mimi. She's very beautiful.
I couldn't help myself, Janet.
She was just like you, only French.
Yes, madam.
What's all this commotion about?
The wedding, madam.
Oh, is there going to be a wedding?
Not anymore. Oh, what a tragedy. What a wonderful, wonderful tragedy. Clear the floorboards. I'll show you how it's done. First you beat it up.
Hey, look at that.
Then you sweet it up.
Ah.
When you heat it up, if it tries to rise, don't let it.
And nattering about the lack of women's restrooms. Ugh, it's cruel. I remember my wedding day. I didn't eat breakfast and the ceremony wasn't until 4 in the afternoon. I do. You're surprised I was married? Well, there you go. Shouldn't go making assumptions about people, should you? I happen to be a very, very, very complicated person. I have to pee now. I'll be back, I promise, but in the meantime, you can listen to the beginning of Act Two.
Oh,
really no see eye to eye.
But Emperor, sometimes a different outlook can change your point of view.
What?
Precisely. What is it about the Asians that fascinates Caucasians? What is it about the Asians that's so nice? Is it the wontons, the egg rolls, the rice? Perhaps it's Buddha or Confucius and their excellent advice.
What? Is it about Caucasians that mystifies we Asians? What is it about Caucasians that's so odd? They caught a pretty lady abroad. They have hair up on their head and they only have one god.
What for?
Impossible!
Wow!
Sorry, sorry! That was not from the Drowsy Chaperone! From another musical entirely. See, I have a woman who comes in once a month. Can you say that? I have a woman. Anyway, she cleans the things that I absolutely refuse to clean. She's very good, but she has this annoying habit of putting my records away. And in the wrong sleeves. Even though I tell her, no touch records, Carmella. No touch records. You know, I suppose if I spoke to her in a complete sense, he'd stop touching my records. Anyway, that song started Act Two of another Gabelenstein show, The Enchanted Nightingale. Degrading piece of chinois surrey about an emperor who's told by a magic bird to marry his American elocutionist instead of his betrothed, and he ends up building the Great Wall of China. A slap in the face to 4,000 years of Chinese history. But it had some wonderful tunes. Anyway, Act Two of The Drowsy Chaperone begins with this. A haunting lament from a very depressed bride. She sings it, sitting on a balcony, bathed in the pale blue light of a sympathetic moon, which is ridiculous, of course, because it's the middle of the day. When you're listening to this next part, try to ignore the lyrics. I know it'll be difficult, but block them out, they're not the best. But the tune is beautiful, and it truly communicates the bride's state of mind. Just ignore the lyrics.
I put a monkey on a pedestal. I try to make that monkey stay. And he did for a time, but he needed to climb and with other monkeys play far away. He left his jacket on. Beside his tiny rusty cup, and I haven't got the strength to pick them up. Oh, monkey, 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 you broke my heart in two. But I'll always say a pedestal.
I'm just gonna pour myself a brandy. The melody is so simple, it just floats on the air. But I must admit, I always get a little bit teary-eyed when I think of that tiny jacket lying on the pedestal, its long sleeves dangling on the floor.
Oh, monkey, monkey, monkey,
you broke my heart in two. But I'll always say a pedestal.
Had a stall
for you. Come, my little monkey. Come, my little monkey. Do.
All right, here it comes.
Wait.
Who are you?
I'm Janet Vandegraaff.
Do you need anyone?
I don't need anyone.
What about the love of one man?
What do I care for the love of one man when I have adored my millions? Do I need?
Wait a minute. But you just love that number! Oh! It has a little bit of everything. A little Bubsy Berkeley. A little Jane Goodall. And that's another thing I love about musical theater in general. When a character is in crisis, they sing and they dance, which is so much more interesting than just whining about it. But, I mean, that's... Oh, you see? This is what I'm talking about. This is life. You managed to be happy for 5 seconds and then something starts ringing!
Now, would you prefer I wait till morning?
All right. I'm gonna stop this record here because I don't want this number ruined by a ringing telephone. Here we have two vaudeville performers who have slipped the cracks of time. They are Noel Fitzpatrick and Ukulele Lil. I don't know anything about them. I suppose Ukulele Lil played the ukulele. Although she doesn't in this show. I actually tried to find out more about her. I went through all my books. I even tried the internet. But alas, all of my searches ended with Tiny Tim's autopsy photographs. Ugh. Anyway, they're both charming.
Why would you have the pews removed?
Oh, the bride has called off the wedding, madam.
Oh, underling, never listen to a bride on her wedding day. Love is a very complex emotion, underling.
Yes, madam.
You could be very close to someone 1 minute, and the next minute, why, you want to strangle them.
Have you got that?
I'm familiar with the urge to strangle, yes.
You see? That's just the nature of love. Love makes lovers worry. Love makes lovers fret. But here's a fact on which we can depend. Just like long ago when Romeo loved Juliet. Love is always lovely in the end.
But the Romeo and Juliet was a tragedy, madam.
Oh, I never read reviews. Love can start a quarrel, love can go to din, but love has always been a trusty friend. 'Twas a happy fate for Henry VIII and Anne Boleyn. Oh, love is always lovely in the end.
Might I remind you, madam, that Anne Boleyn lost her head?
Yes! She was in love!
Oh.
Love was good for Eve and Adam.
Here we go again.
Samson and Delilah, too.
Good grief. May I pose a question, madam?
Why, yes, of course.
Why does nothing I say to you ever get through?
Don't mind if I do.
I found that quite taxing. Excuse me, madam, while I pour myself a glass of ice water.
Love sneaks up behind you. Love drops from above. But love would never consciously open. Love has certainly been kind to me and my true love. Love is always lovely in the end.
But your late husband was a brute!
I don't mean him, you silly coot!
Oh, madam!
Love is always lovely!
Lovely, lovely, lovely!
Love is always lovely in the end!
Yes, that number was charming. But to be frank, on some level that number pisses me off. Now, I'm gonna say something here and yes, I have been drinking. But I'm gonna go out on a limb here and say that love is not always lovely in the end. Often in the end, there are lawyers. And another thing, look, I guess what I'm trying to say is that number is naive. Irresponsibly so. Sorry, I guess that just needed to be said for the benefit of the younger people. I won't interrupt anymore. Oh, there's a moment coming up that I become obsessed with.
Oh, there you are. Oh, Chaperone, I'm in a terrible state.
Oh, you certainly are. You can't go to the wedding looking like that.
Oh, you poor dear, haven't you heard? The wedding's been called off.
Oh, not your wedding. Mine. Well, that reminds me. Might I borrow your veil?
You're getting married, but to whom?
La 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 la.
You're marrying Adolfo?
I know. It's surprising. When I look into his eyes, his big, clumsy eyes, I get all drowsy. That's love, isn't it?
Oh, yes, dear, that is love.
Help me! No, there you are! All right. I'm gonna put my cards on the table, okay? Okay. I can't take this anymore! I got a weak heart, can't take the pressure. If this goes on any longer, Joke Taker's gonna give out! Oh, no, okay. Please, tell me, is there going to be a wedding or not?
Yes!
Thank the Lord in heaven, yes!
Adolfo and the chaperone are getting married.
What?
There you are! I have wonderful news! There's gonna be a wedding!
We know.
You know?
Yes, we just found out.
But who told you?
I did.
But how did you know?
What difference does it make?
Mrs. Tottenham and I are to be married in the garden at 7:30 this evening.
What?
Oh, yes!
Congratulations to everyone!
Say, what kind of talk mini wedding is this, huh? I mean, everybody getting married except the bride and groom. Go!
Oh, there you are. Aw, oh, Janet, I've been looking everywhere for you.
Hello, Mr. Martin.
Oh, please don't be that way. Can't you find it in your heart to marry me? Janet, it's our wedding day. George has gone through all this trouble and... Well, I do love you. More than I can say.
But you kissed another woman!
Yes, I know. I just can't understand it. Look, I know this may sound ridiculous. But when I was kissing that French girl, why? It was just like kissing you.
Oh, Robert, you were kissing me.
What?
You mean you're Mimi? Well, that French accent was remarkably accurate.
Why, thank you. I developed it in playing the role of Monique in Hold That Baguette.
There you are. Before you do anything, think about this. No matter how well you play the part of the happy wife, you'll never, ever get a standing ovation.
Oh, I just don't know what to do. Oh, Chaperone, please, I beg you, just this one time, give me some advice that is coherent and appropriate to the situation. Should I marry Robert?
All right, here it comes, the moment I was telling you about. Not only the culmination of the plot, but a moment that has fascinated me more than any other, and it's brought me back to this record time and time again. Here it comes.
Well, my advice to you is...
And this is it, listen.
While you can.
You see, you can't quite make out what she says because someone drops a cane. I'll play it for you again.
While you can.
Is she saying live while you can or leave while you can?
While you can.
Now, it's Beatrice Stockwell, so it might just be a cynical quip, but... Well, that's exactly what you're thinking, isn't it? When you're standing there at the altar, live or leave. And you have to live, right? You choose to live, because... Because you... You do love her in some way. It's not an exact size, and an arrow doesn't come out of the sky and point to the person they're supposed to be with. So one day, you say it to someone. You say, I love you. And you basically phrase it as a question, but they accept it as fact, and then suddenly, there she is, standing in front of you, in a $3,000 dress, with tears in her eyes, and her nephew made the hoopah, so what do you do? You say I was joking? I was kidding! No! No, you live right, you choose to live. So, for the next couple of months, you stare at the alien form in the bed beside you, and you think to yourself, who are you? Who are you? And then one day you say it out loud, and then it's trial separation and couples counseling, and all of your conversations are about her eating disorder and your Zoloft addiction. And you're constantly redefining and reevaluating and revisiting until you finally lose the deposit on the house and the whole relationship ends on a particularly ugly note with an only copy of Gypsy spinning in the air and smashing against the living room wall! But in a larger sense, in a broader sense, it's better to have lived than left, right?
Well, you can!
You have no idea how many times I've listened to that.
Chaperone, you certainly have a way with words. Robert, my answer is yes. I will marry you.
It looks like this wedding is a done deal.
Now you're in trouble.
And there is nothing you can do about it.
But there is. I found a replacement. A new leading lady. Presenting Kitty the Incredible. Okay, now Kitty, show the boys that you can read my mind, okay? My mind.
Kitty! Will you marry me? Holy cats, Mr. Felton! Yes! Yes! Oh!
Isn't she amazing?
Well, what are you guys waiting for? You ladies go put on your frillies. We'll all get married in one big clump. That's how they do it in Utah.
Well, George, I don't know how you managed to pull it off. 1, 2, 3, 4 weddings in one day. I guess you're everyone's best man now.
I am?
Well, George!
I am!
Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray!
He's George, that's George, the best. Man, George,
I'm honored to be doing what a best man ought.
He's basking in the glory of a fight well fought. Wedding bells will ring, ha! Wedding bells will chime. Wedding bells will celebrate a happy wedding time.
Oh no, I forgot the minister! Oh,
I'll fix my navigator. we'll have this fix in 2 shakes. Then it's off to Rio for carnival.
Oh. Wait, the captain of a ship can perform a marriage.
Yes!
And a pilot is comparable to a captain.
Yes!
And an airplane is a kind of a tip. You know, a tip of air? Some might call it an air tip.
Oh, ship! Yes!
Wait, I got it. Tricks. You can marry everybody on this plane, and we'll all have the honeymoon in Rio!
Oh,
a bride and groom in a chapel may bring a tear to the eye, but what a thrill when love a trill I do in the sky. When vows are said in
a middle,
daffodils
yourself be distracted. I'll find the fuse box.
It's the super!
Oh, God.
Ha!
Hello?
Door latch or amped?
Yes.
Yeah, we had to shut the power off because we had to replace the breaker panel in the basement!
Yes.
So we replaced the old breaker panel pop me trick.
Yes.
I'm sorry, that's what happened.
It's so normal.
Yes.
So we're going to reset your breaker.
Now?
Oh my God, baby, only take 1 second.
All right.
You know, I tried calling you earlier before, but how come there's no answer?
Oh, I've been having a problem with the phone. Really? Well, goodbye! Well, that's it. Moment is ruined. One note away from the end of the show and the mood is broken. You know what I should do? I should just start the record from the beginning again. No. No, I can't do that, can I? Oh, it's so frustrating. You have to understand. I love this show so much. And I've never even seen it. My mother gave me the record. This is just before my father left us. Oh, he didn't leave because of it, although I'm sure it didn't help matters much. Look, what I'm trying to say is, I know it's not a perfect show. The spit-take scene is lame, and the murky motif is labored. But none of that matters. It does what a musical is supposed to do. It takes you to another world, and it, well, it gives you a little tune to carry with you in your head, you know. A little something to help you escape the dreary horrors of the real world. A little something for when you're feeling blue. You know? As we stumble along on life's funny journey, as we stumble along into the blue, we look here and we look there, seeking answers anywhere, never sure of where to turn or what
time an accident waiting to happen.
Still we bumble away.